Good evening. As you're all aware, one of our past administrative board member and a very senior member of IBPC who passed away recently, Mr. Kiran Sanghani, we would like to observe a 1 minute silence for him, and I would request all of you to stand up and observe the silence and pray for the departed soul. Now let's welcome our president, Mrs. Bindu Chettur, to come and give her welcome and presidential address. Give a round of applause to Ms. Bindu.
Respected speakers, Administrative Board of IBPC, my dear family of IBPC, a very good evening, namaskar, assalamu alaikum. I am deeply honored to be here to address you today for the first time as the president of IBPC. I thank each one of you for believing me, trusting in my capability to lead this prestigious entity. I thank, on behalf of our new board of IBPC, everybody for reposing your faith in us. And I ensure that the coming 2 years, we will work very hard to see that IBPC will be taken to a very new level. We will introduce new strides. This new board will introduce new strides to see that the relationship between India and UAE will be more, and also both the nations will prosper from that. My dear members of IBPC, it is only because of your blessings, because of your support, because of your confidence in us, we are here today as the new board. Today, we are all here to discuss a very relevant topic, VAT, value added tax. If anybody is going to say, can we give an award to any word most talked about? No doubt it will be VAT. Why? So far, we were discussing only about tax-free UAE. There was no tax. So from the tax-free to the tax regime, this transition is going to take place. And it is duty of the IBPC, for all of us, and especially for the board, to take care to give you the best advice. Because this is not only technical know-how, there is mental block. So we should be able to face it with full-fledged knowledge. Hence, we have here eminent experts, accomplished chartered accountants, who will enlighten you with the technical know-how and also will be answering all your queries. Ladies and gentlemen, VAT is the most simple indirect form of tax. This was first introduced in France in 1954. Thereafter, in 1968, it was also introduced in New Zealand. Today, 150 nations implemented VAT, including European Union, New Zealand, Canada, Australia, Singapore, Malaysia. And so, if so many may be knowing about it, even in India, the central GST, goods service tax, is another form of consumption tax. So why VAT in UAE? Everybody will be asking. Because we get so many services from the government as public transport. There are so many other services done by the government. But where is the income for the government? This is where the question of VAT came. So, it is nothing negative. Actually, only in 2018, January, this is going to get implemented, and only 5% each. And so many goods are exempted from tax. So we should know about all this nitty-gritty, what is what. So that is why this session has been arranged today. Apart from that, this nation should have decreased dependency on the oil revenues, increased for the diversification of so many other ways wherein which the government will collect the tax and will give back to the public with better services. It is like a long journey. We'll start with a first step. So this is not the end. Today we are going to give an initiative session only. We will be having more engagements, interactions, making you well-versed, ready, knowledgeable about this particular subject.
I'm extremely delighted to see a full packed hall here. It's my pleasure to welcome all of you to this wonderful, wonderful evening. As we get into the thick and thin of our IBPC board engagements, we start today with something which is very, very decisive, something that's going to impact all of us here, and also which is going to impact people around 6 Gulf countries. Yes. Today, we are going to talk about value-added tax, VAT, VAT. As we all know that VAT will be soon implemented across the region, very, very soon, that's early next year, which is a major shift from a non-tax-paying environment to a tax-paying environment. I'm actually extremely happy and honored to see our past presidents here amongst us. And we would like to honor you, sir, with a bouquet of flowers. And I would like to request Mr. Mahendra Usher to come by. We can present a bouquet to Mr. Abbas Ali Mirza. And also, I'd like to invite Mr. Bhagwan Jatwani to come by and present the bouquet to Dr. Bharat Bhutani ji. Now I'd like to welcome our Vice President, Mr. Hemant Jatwani, to give a detailed information, introduction about the speakers.
Good evening. Honorable President, respected members of the board, the IBPC colleagues. This is our first session post the election, so I'll take a couple of minutes to thank each and every one of you who has voted us into office. Thank you very much for turning up on the voting day in good numbers and voting us. Rest assured, we are here to serve the community, and we will leave no stone unturned to make sure that we live up to your expectations and perhaps exceed them. We will raise the baton higher for the fellow members, for the institution, and for our two countries that we represent and that we have adopted as our working home here. So our very best wishes, all the best. Now, for the first event that we have selected for the members, we have two very prolific speakers and experts on the subject of VAT. As has been mentioned by speakers before me, value-added tax, ladies and gentlemen, is a red-hot burning subject that is bound to impact each and every one of us as we progress ahead in time. Those that came here and made Dubai their home many, many years and decades ago have been living in the lap of a tax haven. Unfortunately, like all good things come to an end, this is expected to become a part of history as well. VAT is being implemented by UAE and possibly other GCC nations as well, with effect from 1st of January 2018. A well-planned and executed implementation of VAT will result in benefits for all your businesses in respect of ongoing compliance, management of risks, as well as cash flow management. Therefore, allow me to introduce the speakers who will take you further on the subject. We have Mr. Neeraj Shah, if you will kindly stand up and be recognized. A qualified chartered accountant from India. Being an excellent academia, he has secured 6th rank in Inter-CA and 36th in the finals. He has specialized in tax and finance and has professionally advised on various cross-border transactions, on international and domestic tax implementations, and related regulatory perspective. He's the director of FAME Advisory DMCC, a consulting firm specializing in advising on corporate structures, succession planning, VAT, etc. Our second speaker of the day is Mr. Ashwin Dedia. If he can please stand up. Thank you so much. Also a chartered accountant, information system auditor, and a Microsoft certified professional. On a professional side, he engages with companies for business process automation, setting up MIS and business intelligence, reporting frameworks, and mentoring technology projects. His expertise on tele and his integration with other technologies has helped him to be recognized as a teleguru. He has delivered sessions on a wide range of topics, including MIS, business integration, HR process, outsourcing, VAT, GST, and optimal use of accounting software applications across India, Southeast Asia, and Gulf. He's a mentor at the FAME Training Institution. So without further ado, gentlemen, the floor is yours. For the members, I would just like to say that we have kept a reasonably long session for Q&As. So I would request that kindly hold back your questions up to the end, and then we can have it during the Q&A session. Thank you, and I hope you'll enjoy the session.
Thank you, Mr. Jatwani, for the introduction. Now I'd like to call upon Mr. Ashwin Dedia onto the stage and then do the presentation.
At the outset, let me thank all of you and IBPC in particular for the opportunity for sharing and discussing with you about value-added tax. VAT talk or value-added talk tax and the discussion around it. I'm really glad and comfortable to discuss around or understand, have an interaction with you on value-added tax. Today we are going to have a quick introduction or quick understanding about VAT and some basic concepts around it. So concepts about it, some clarity of the concepts, some administrative aspects, the accounting of VAT, and the business impact of it. Some part of it will be discussed by me, and the specifics about it pertaining to business impact and all would be taken up by my colleague Nirav. Now, VAT as a aspect, generally I prefer to have an interactive session, but considering the information or the sharing that was there, we will have this session right away and then we would have a question answer there. So VAT, about the VAT basics and such things. Now what is VAT? Before VAT, VAT is nothing but a tax, and a typical element of a tax is something which is imposed on someone to be paid, and finally it is the state which collects it, and it is an element of a fear there which makes it implied. If someone does not pay, someone does not comply with it, they are penalized. And that's the core reason where the tax has a fear element attached to it. Probably we all pay variety of charges to the governments, to the bodies, but the moment the term tax comes in, an element of fear gets attached to it, a stigma gets attached to it, because anything, any error into it leads to some penal action, some actions against it. Basically, when I bifurcate the tax, tax are basically of two parts, two types, the direct and the indirect, where a direct tax is something which is imposed on the person and the same person is required to pay it. So typical examples like income tax, wealth tax, or the similar ones, property tax and so, they are imposed on the person and the same person is liable to pay the tax. And the second element is an indirect tax, where indirect tax is a tax which is actually paid by A, but the real impact of it is on B, on someone else. And across the globe, indirect tax is one of the major source of revenue for any government. Direct taxes contribute to a smaller portion of the whole revenue for the government, and indirect taxes cover up major part of it. Few of the indirect taxes even we are paying. Here, like one perception for many of us is, it's a tax-free zone here. Are we paying tax in Dubai? Answer is yes. While we do import and local sales, we are paying customs. That is also a tax, and it's an indirect tax. Only thing, the tax is not pervasive, not applied to many, hence it is not so discussed or not so concerned with others. Only those who import and sell locally are administering that part of the taxation, and that's all. But with VAT, which is also one of the indirect tax, this will become pervasive to all. Many of us would get impacted with it as regards to our business processes are concerned. And we just were scanning across few understandings or definitions of VAT, and we felt this is something which exhaustively gives a clarity on VAT, what VAT is. So typically, it's a tax on domestic consumption, a consumption-based tax as our president were referring to. So a tax which is not on trade but on consumption, which is a very important element. So it is not a tax on the business, it is the tax on consumption, the last mile consumer. And basically, it is levied at each stage of the distribution chain or the cycle of business. So effectively, at every stage, whenever the amount gets increased in terms of the value of the product or the service, the tax element which is getting added up, or the value that is getting added up, is converted into a tax percentile, and that is going back to the government. So the collection of this is to the government in a continuous and a sustainable mode. Unlike the sales tax, which is also a consumption-based tax, but over there the tax is charged and collected only at the end by the reseller to the final consumer. Till that point, there is no tax in between. So that element of sales tax leads to a probability of missouts and evasions more easily. Whereas in case of value-added tax, this probability of evasion is eliminated a bit. We'll just understand few of the features, and probably that would give us a clarity. Yes, as was mentioned earlier, VAT as a process, as a tax element, got introduced in 54, but the initial conceptualization of VAT was done well earlier in 1918 by Dr. Siemens, but he was not able to convince the government of the value of it. Finally, France initiated this concept, and today, how many countries are there? Like as was mentioned, around 150. Just see the parameter or the spread of VAT across. Practically, it is spread across the continents, and VAT is applicable in most of these countries. Some places it is titled as VAT, some other places it is titled as Goods and Service Tax or GST, or a similar nomenclature. But VAT and GST are the common nomenclatures used across the globe, and practically more than 150 countries are already having this tax in place. So why or what is that exactly would get impacted to you? So typically we are all hearing it is a 5% tax over here in UAE. Yet the draft law is coming, but probably they would not change the percentage of it. Whereas the global average is above 15. So somewhere between 15 and 16 is the global average. Whereas in UAE, it is going to be just 5%. Many of us might be regular travelers to various countries, having business connections and business interests in different countries and continents. We are accustomed to taxation over there. Here, it is new. And that's one of the concern areas or the fear generators in this economy. Let us see what are the places where they were and what is the average rate of taxes around there. So, in UK, in 73, this was introduced, replacing the sales tax. So, tax was already there prior to that also. But the average rate is between 0 and 20. The rate is between 0 and 20, and the filing of returns are mostly quarterly. Same way in Europe, the common rate is from 0 to 27, but the most common average across various countries is 70 to 27, whereas we are just talking about 5% here. And the return filing submission process is at different intervals based on the turnover, based on various other parameters across there, type of industry and so on. In India, VAT as such was introduced in 2005. GST is now coming up, we all know, 1st July onwards. And This also has a different state-wise, different ranges, and based on turnover, the return parameters are changing. So based on the turnover, some companies are required to file the returns monthly, some are filing it quarterly, some are just filing annually a composite returns also, a consolidated ones. In Kenya, so typically I tried to take a few examples of different continents, countries from different continents, the West, the India, where the eastern continent of India, then Kenya, African part, as well as Egypt, someone who has just recently adapted a tax system like VAT. So in such places, the returns are either monthly or quarterly. So the lesser the time given for filing the return, more the pressure on the business to comply and to complete the documentation. Generally, a quarterly return is something which helps the business to administer record keeping and structuring more easily. Now, few of the features just we all have discussed, and I just tried to highlight a couple of features over there. Like VAT is a consumption-based tax. What exactly by this do I mean? It is a tax which is applied to me when I'm consuming the product or the service at the last mile, not as a business, but as a consumer. If I am a business and I'm consuming or using the service, typically I would get input credit of the VAT and I would be able to set off that particular VAT that I have paid across. But if I am a last mile consumer, I don't have an opportunity to set off the VAT that I have paid while making the purchases. So final burden, final burn remains with the consumer. Same way, compliance rate is average. So most of the companies prefer to comply with it, but naturally, yes, the smaller entities, smaller businesses would prefer to be out of the VAT structure for various reasons that we would just discuss few of them. It's easy to collect and track from the government's point of view because the onus of administration is purely on the business, not on the government. Unlike in sales tax, the business can say, I have not sold to a consumer, I have sold to another business entity only. And over there, government has to go back and trace whether the sales was really to the last mile consumer or the business. Whereas here, it is very easy and very administratively very convenient. Fine, whoever is doing, you charge the VAT. If he is a consumer, he would not come back to claim. If he is a business, naturally, they would come back and claim the VAT. So what exactly is the core element into it for control perspective? From a control perspective, very simple and core element is VAT has to be charged the moment I'm making a sale or a buyer is buying a particular goods or service. So it is collected from the seller, by the seller, from the buyer at the time of making the sales. At the time of making the sales is a very important element, not at the time of consumption. I may buy something today to be consumed later, though it is a consumption tax, but I have to pay VAT right now. Same way, determination of the tax structures and the rates is typically based on the local administration authority which is there in the region in which I am registered as a business. So I may have a business in UAE, I would have a different tax structure. I may have a business in UK, I would have a different tax structure. So tax structure is basically based on the locality or the jurisdiction in which I am residing as a business. And it is collected completely from the end purchaser. And seller does not pay a single money, single cash out of his own pocket. Now this is something which is very important for businesses to know. Is tax VAT a cost to my business or no? So the primary direct answer is it is not a direct cost to your business. It is a mechanism where you are collecting a tax, and for all the tax element that you have already paid while purchasing, you are just adjusting that and balance you are paying. So you are not paying out of your pocket. It is just a transitionary effect of tax that you are administering on behalf of the government or the tax authority. Same way, some advantages of VAT. Definitely, yes. One uniform rate comes in, so administration becomes easy. Those who have dealt in India with the sales tax, they might be knowing different rates, different states, different combinations of based on the type of business I am, above the sales tax, turnover tax and all that. So combinations of taxes and the variants were literally creating confusions and the risk of evasion possibilities. which goes away here. It becomes simple for administration as well as for the businesses. Same way, VAT is levied successively at different stages, from production to the final consumption and the distribution. So everyone pays the VAT, collects the PAT and pays the VAT. Collection is at each stage and the full amount is never to be paid back by the business. He is paying only the differential amount for the VAT that he has already paid. He is getting a credit or refund and adjustment of it. So effectively he is paying only the balance amount. We'll understand or we'll just glance through it through an example later. At the same time, there are a few disadvantages or few more advantages in that. So VAT introduces fairness and uniformity across the process of taxation. VAT ensures better compliances because it is easy to track, easy to and align. And transparency is something which is one of the key elements which comes into with the VAT introduction for a state. So from the government point of view, it becomes an easy administration tool compared to any other form of indirect tax. Two disadvantages. VAT is regressive and hence it impacts the cost of living in a particular location, in a particular country, in a particular locality. By that, what is the going to be a typical impact on the cost of living for all of us? We would have an increased cost of living by something less than 5%. Why I'm saying less than 5%? Because many of the basic elements of usage of our day-to-day life may be exempt. And hence, for the last mile consumer as an individual staying in the country, we would have an impact of something lesser than 5%. Whereas in many countries, the impact is somewhere between less than their peak tax rate or typically in the range of 12 to 15% as a cost of inflation. Here, it would have an impact on cost of inflation at something less than 5%. Same way, this would impact the poor highest. Because it is a consumption tax. Consumption of a rich and a poor does not vary majorly. Basic consumption elements would be on the same range, but his income varies big way. So for a mid-income person or a poor person, the percentage of tax that goes out would be far higher compared to the percentage of tax which a rich person or a well-to-do family would be really paying out. So that way, it impacts the poor very heavily. Same way, implementation of VAT has an administrative burden, but to the businesses, not to the government. For government, it is less burden, but for businesses, it is big burden. Many companies have to really administer this complete record keeping, which may not be their current practice or may not be familiarity. This is something which would bring in a lot of administrative hassles and challenges to be addressed and structured up. VAT could hamper the appeal of the goods and services that I am offering to. Typically, if the buyer is an unregistered dealer, if I am in a B2B business and if I am selling to a not unregistered dealer, probably he would not be happy to buy from me. He would prefer to search out another vendor who is not VAT registered, so he gets without VAT services or facilities. So that much component of or that much impact would be there onto businesses, dealing to businesses with unregistered dealers more so. Then benefits to the economy. It's a single taxation. So, and it is on the consumption and a single tax rate, easy to administer. Same way, constant revenue flow for the government. It gives a continuous flow to the government because VAT is collected at each stage. So some momentum happens in the economy, some money goes to the government. On the both sides, if there is a reduction in the price, government has to pay back also to the in the form of VAT refunds and such things. But effectively, there is a continuous momentum rather than a single point of money collection, unlike in the sales tax regime. Over there, only money was collected when the last product was sold to the consumer. All the manufacturing chain, if it takes, say, for example, 18 months, tax will be given to the government only at the end of 18 months. Whereas here, at each stage of that cycle, some money would move to the economy, some money would go to the government, and accordingly, it will have a positive impact to the economy. Definitely, yes, because of this, financial stability would be more, sustainability would be better, and predictability of the cash flow would be better for the economy to be planned right. people will be attracted towards more saving. This is again a impact of VAT for individuals. Now, as an individual, if I know whatever I am consuming, there is an element of tax into it, and it is going to impact a natural human tendency of how many of us over here like to pay tax? Practically none. If given a choice, and that's what exactly we are here for. Right? A choice is there, and we are here in a tax-free region. So this is a human tendency. So moment we say, we find ki if a particular purchase I am going to do, and it is going to have a tax element into it, we would try to postpone that purchase. Effectively convert it to an increased saving in the economy. So people would be averse on spending, and that would have an immediate impact in the first few months or first few quarters of the implementation of taxation in an economy. And they would be attracted towards more savings. Same way, benefit to the business. For many businesses, we were discussing informally also with few of them. And the first or the most clear benefit is it will ease business dealings. Things will be more simpler, more clearer. Today we are facing many people having a challenge. Bill comes from one entity, payment goes to another entity, reconciliation becomes a bigger headache because it's a group company. Sometimes entity sends invoice from one of the legal entities of theirs, and the payment is going to the another group entity of theirs, and so on. So internal transfers, journals, and reconciliation becomes a headache. Here, this would make it more simpler, more cleaner. Same way, VAT refunds would be an incentive for the businesses to really enter into and structure up the businesses more clean way and more easier way, because the moment you are dealing with a VAT registered dealer, the invoice that comes to you has a VAT details onto it, and it is a tax invoice with VAT amount into it. This amount is nothing but your currency, which you can use for paying your taxes. It boosts the business profile. Small and mid-sized businesses would be benefited by boosting of the business profiles, because any company would be interested to, like today also, when we deal with companies in India, one of the few elements that we check is this company registered with VAT, service tax, and so on? Oh, that means it is sizably good. It is not a very small entity. So a factor of comfort comes in first, whereas otherwise we would prefer to avoid dealing with such entities. So registration with VAT helps the business to boost the profile and project as a slightly larger and good company. Same way, because of this, administrative facilities would also set up into the business out of force by law, but that would help the business to be more structured, more stable, and it reduces the risk. This is something which I got input from one of a session like this. And I was surprised how it reduces the risk for a business. VAT reduces the risk, and typically the risk of bad debts for a business. In the normal scenario, what happens out is the bad debt is something more so because of disowning of the supply to the person. Beyond other aspects, the person says, no, you have not supplied this much worth value, you have supplied lesser worth value or lesser element to me. The moment VAT is there, and the person has claimed the VAT in his return as a refund, naturally has accepted and acknowledged that much value of purchase. So any dispute would be more favorable for the supplier than the buyer if he has accepted and agreed, taken the input credit of it. That means he has acknowledged that much purchase by him, and that helps in settlement of issues whenever there are there, and this helps in a reduction in risk by the businesses. Typically, there are two categories of supplies in VAT. One is simple one, taxable. The other one is not taxable or exempt ones. The exempt are something which are generally listed by the government, listed by the tax authority, and all others are taxable. Beyond the exempt list, everything is taxable in the VAT regime. Now, what is basically exempt? Generally, the goods of necessities, something which are of local importance, something which would be really needing some support into the local economy as a business or as a structure. And no VAT is charged on such goods. Not only that, but those goods which are exempt, a dealer of it is not even required to maintain records and submit the records to the government for them. Whereas in taxable, again, there are two elements. One is zero rated and the regular rated, normal rated. And taxable goods and services mandate every person to supply or provide the details of the transactions to the government. In this, the zero rated are typically based on few parameters which may be set up by the government or the process, which are typically type of transactions. So a simple example is exports would be effectively going into a zero rated details. Further breakup and further details will be taken up into the further discussions, but primarily these are zero rated, where you are required to submit the details to the government, but the tax rate is zero, and hence the tax value also becomes zero. And the normal rated are all other goods which are neither exempt nor zero rated, all the sets of transactions and so on. The simpler test to identify and determine the taxability is the sale of or supply of goods and services. Yes. Then check the next point, whether it is happening in a taxable territory or a tax-free territory. Like if the sale and supply is happening from UAE today, it is out of the taxable territory, so tax is not applicable. The moment it is happening from a taxable territory, VAT is applicable or tax is applicable. Third element is it being done by an entity or a person who is taxable, who is registered for the particular compliance? If yes, then only the taxable tax element would come and the supply will become taxable. Otherwise, supply will not be taxable. And the last into it, it should be a regular course of my business, not a outside the business transaction. So personal gifting by me to someone or a exchange of goods by an individual to with another individual may not attract VAT or tax, because I am not a registered person. So any of this factor, if not complied with or not getting checklisted out, checked out, would make sure these goods are not taxable and tax is not levied. So this is a simple litmus test to identify whether the supply is taxable or no. Then quickly I will take few administrative aspects of it. Few of them are like return, registration, returns and audits. So in registration, we have to register with the VAT authority or the tax authority, whichever would be there. Registration is basically based on some parameters like compliance of or completeness of some particular value, turnover, and then further. And further to it, there is an option of voluntary registration. So one who is complying or completing a particular limit of a turnover, he or she has to register, and the others are having a choice to register or not to register. Then the registration profit, definitely, as we saw, few advantages of two businesses, similar advantages are there here. So it gives a business a good boost, good profiling. It helps them to take the VAT refund for whatever they are purchasing or consuming across. And ultimately, the VAT number can be appealing to other firms with whom they are dealing. So they would consider dealing with a registered entity more easily than unregistered ones. Few disadvantages. As natural as it adds up to the burden to the business. So if my business is small enough, I would prefer to be out of the registration network, because it will lead to additional administrative work for me. So if the business is very small, it is advisable to be out of the registration network, though in such cases, the VAT that I am paying would become my cost itself, because I am then the consumer. So this way, few of these things, it adds to paperwork and so on. And the returns. Once I am a registered dealer, then I have to file returns or I have to submit data to the government or the tax authority. This submission or these returns are basically submitted or required to be submitted periodically, and the details should show the transactions that I have done for the taxable and the related products and services. Then once I have filed or once I have submitted the returns, the next element is someone has to validate or verify whether this submission is correct or not correct. In a normal scenario, this validation is done by the auditors at the end of a period. So it may be a generally annual review or annual audit. Most of the auditors or the accountants would support or verify the data that you have submitted out, verify them, and confirm that the submission is complete and accurate. This is, in many countries, voluntary. In few countries, it is mandated by the law also. And the second one is audit by authorities. So audit that are mandated by the authorities. So few authorities may feel there is some suspicion into the transaction. There is a probability of tax evasion. They may push across this submission to the respective auditor or audit departments within the tax authorities, and they would be taking up the details of audit and reviews. And then the business impact of it. So for the business impact, I would just ask Nirav to take over further from here. Thank you.
Good evening. Respected past presidents of IBPC, board members, and ladies and gentlemen. So far, we have covered basic overview of how VAT is in various geographies and given you an overview of what we can expect reasonably of the administration and the law that is going to be. Now we are going to get into some more details and some more aspects which will impact or start impacting us practically as well. And few things that I would like to mention here is that, first of all, like our president said, why is it so important? Because in the history of 45 years of UAE, this is the first comprehensive set of legislation which is going to enforce us towards compliance, towards the tax laws. It's not only first for the business community, it's also first for the government. Please understand that as well. They are having equal difficulty in finalizing the law itself because they are also faced with same amount of challenges that we are faced with. So it's not only a first for us, it's first for them as well. In that scenario, what is it that we expect? It's best based on what our experience with government so far is, that we expect a fair administration of a law. And believe me, for next one and a half year, it's going to be a learning process. As much as it's for us, it's going to be a learning process for government as well. And here, organizations like IBPC will have to play a very, very crucial role and convey from time to time the difficulties which are faced in each of the business segment to the government and to the right forum and represent, make representation from time to time to amend that suitably. And that's where I would recommend the board to look at it more seriously and continuously, because this is next one and a half year, it's a learning process. If GST in India can become a learning process for last 2 years and going 1.5 year with the size and amount of country and with so many legislation already in place, this legislation being introduced for the first time in a country which has never experienced tax laws or compliance mechanism, we'll have to bear with this for next 1.5, 2 years. So let's join the learning process. So my journey today, my discussion today is more about sharing and learning, and let's all learn together. Okay. With that, we have divided it in three parts. The business impact initially for trade within the local economy, within the UAE, trade within the member countries, GCC. Here I'll give you some example of what happens within the EU as a European Union and what happens when goods move from one country to other or services are rendered from one country to other. And we may fairly expect that similar mechanism might come. Of course, we'll have to see the draft law when it comes and what it specifies. But I'm giving you some example on that line. And then, of course, the trade with the rest of the world and how it's going to move for us. So local economy is very simple. Any selling to business or consumer, you need to charge VAT at normal rates. The rates are 5% for all the taxable commodities, except for those which are zero rated or exempt. And if you're buying, you're receiving goods or services for the purpose of your business, and you will generally get a VAT paid tax. And this is what you need to, we'll come to the details as to what we need to then do with each of this and how we have to maintain the details going forward. When it comes to trade within the GCC, this example I'm giving you from the practice which is followed within the EU, when the goods move from one country to other, instead of calling it an export or import, they call it a dispatch and receive. So supply of goods, they change the terminology to use a technically known as a dispatch or removal from one country, and then addition to the economy of the other. And term export has a slightly different meaning. Only when it goes outside the EU or GCC in our case, it'll be termed as export. So again, these are expectations, but I'm just sharing with you. So VAT applicability, when you are dispatching it to another country like export, you don't have to charge VAT. But there's something called N, rest of the dispatches, for it to be normal rated supplies. So what happens is that there is a concept of a reverse charge mechanism which comes into play in such a case. The company which is, say, in UAE and is supplying to somebody in Oman will not charge VAT at 5% and it will be zero rated, provided the recipient is also a VAT registered entity in Oman. However, when the recipient receives the good, it will have to charge a VAT at an applicable rate in Oman. So if it is 5% here, assume it is 5% there also. They'll have to charge a 5% rate on the import and then push the goods forward in the VAT chain. This is known as a reverse charge mechanism in the technical terms. So selling to businesses, you normally do not charge. What you have to, you may still deduct VAT that you have paid on your purchases. You'll still get that. Selling to consumers who are not VAT registered, you will have to charge at the normal rate. And again, buying, as I explained, as if you had sold the goods to yourself, you'll have to charge a VAT and record it as your input credit. And then, of course, it goes on forward. So like this, so this is the scenario in EU which I have taken example from. So if a customer in other member country is a VAT registered and provides you with a valid VAT registration number, you can apply a zero rate and it will be due or paid in the destination country. It's compulsory to maintain records, and it's you have to also maintain a record that the goods have actually been physically removed from that country within a certain stipulated timeline. When you trade with the rest of the world, it's simple. It's export. It will not be charged to VAT because it's not local consumption. And even though you have exported the goods, whatever input VAT you've got, you can still take a credit of that and refund it. And in buying, like the reverse charge mechanism, if you're importing the goods, in addition to your custom duty, you will have to charge a VAT and then push the goods into the VAT chain. So again, the reverse charge mechanism is what is known as. Services, the place of supply of service is the most crucial aspect. So far, the indication or information that we have from Ministry of Finance is not entirely clear. All that they have said is that for services, the registration of the service, service, the person who is rendering the service or the where he is based is going to be the place of supply. And therefore, what happens with the export of services, it's still not clarified. So we'll have to still await for the draft law. But technically, or what is prevalent in other countries, we will have to see that it's generally the same, that if your customer is outside the country, then you do not charge the VAT, and you may still claim the credits that you have. And if it is import of services, again, is the same mechanism that you, or the concept that you follow with the goods. Now we come to VAT accounting. Again, this is very important because taking lead from what Ashwin just mentioned, that for most of the intermediary businesses which are in the trading pipeline, this is not a cost. This is not a P&L item. It's going to be more a balance sheet item where you'll track what you have paid so far on your inputs and what you have collected on all your sales or revenues. And you will net off the two and pay the difference or claim the refund of the if you have paid excess. So effectively, it's not a cost. It becomes a cost where the chain is broken. So if you are in the business where your output or your revenue is from the goods or services which are exempted, then you are not allowed to charge, and therefore you don't get credit. So in that event, all your cost, all your input cost becomes a cost for you. If you are in a business which has partial exemption, you will have to maintain a pro rata different segregation of how much it is for the exempt goods and how much it is for the normal goods, and accordingly claim. And this is where the entire process of zero rating or exempt is very, very important. If it is zero rated, you can still claim credit of the input that you have paid. For example, exports. It is zero rated. But you can still claim all the credit of the input that you have paid and claim refund of that. But if it is exempt, then whatever you have paid, which is proportionately used for those exempt goods or services, you will not be able to claim a refund. It will be a cost for you. And this is where the entire accounting, bookkeeping, maintenance of records, all that will be extremely, extremely, extremely important. So that's where the compliance cost will start coming in, and that's the aspect that one needs to build in, and the cash flow cost. So we'll see what are the example of flow of VAT. So if person X sells the goods at 1,000, I'm sorry, it's a little small, sells the good at 1,000, 5% VAT charge at 50, there's no input for him, he pays 50 to the government. If the next person in the line sells it for 3,000, he'll charge 150 as VAT, however, he'll claim 50 as input VAT and only pay the difference. And the final retailer will charge at 5,000, he will charge 250 as the VAT, 150 he'll claim as a input credit, and only 100 he'll pay. In sum, the total amount paid by all three put together is 250, which is the final amount that is borne by the consumer. And therefore, again, if you see in this example also, it's not added to every sales and purchase because it's not a cost. Typical invoice format, you will have to maintain all these details. You have to clearly maintain what the percentage you are charging. These are the things that you'll need to cover: date of transaction, sequential number, VAT details of supplier, address, mailing of the buyer, product quantity, rate, value, how much is the total taxable value, and what is the total amount due. These are just simple things which are all prevalent in all the other countries as well. VAT on tax invoice, we have to charge, you have to show it very clearly. Output VAT is the seller's liability to pay to the government. Buyer is registered VAT entity, VAT paid on purchase will be termed as input VAT, and input VAT is allowed to be set off against your liability of output VAT. And if you are not a registered entity, then it becomes a cost for you. Or if you are dealing in the exempt good, it becomes a cost for you. Therefore, just the concept-wise, what is input is something that you have paid on your purchases. What is output is something that you have collected on your sales or your revenue. And this too needs to be netted off. Based on that, the balance is something that you either pay to the government or you claim as a refund from the government. Simple calculation, I'm just taking a simple example. Of course, all of you are fairly aware, but purchases, say I have done a purchase of 100,000 dirhams, out of which only 70,000 are the taxable purchases. Expenses of 25,000 dirham, only 10,000 are the taxable expenses, and sales of 100,000 again. VAT paid is on 80,000 at 5% at 4,000 dirham. I have charged VAT on 100,000 at 5% of 5,000. So net amount that I'll need to pay is only 1,000. So output VAT on local sales is 5,000. Input VAT on local purchases is 4,000, which includes not only purchases but also expenses. Please bear this in mind. VAT payable then becomes 1,000. So let's just take a look at what are the quick facts that we know so far about VAT in UAE. And this is again based on information given time to time by Ministry of Finance at various forums and on the website and other things. Applicable from 1st January, rate is probably going to be 5%. Returns are likely to be quarterly. Turnover registration threshold, again, if you compare internationally, this is quite a low threshold. So the aim is to cover most of the participants within the network net. So mandatory is above AD 375,000. Voluntary is above 187,500, that's the turnover, and not allowed if you have a turnover of less than 187,500. Typically in other smaller countries, the threshold are much higher. Say Singapore has a 1 million Singapore dollar as a threshold, and few others. So here the intent is to cover most and many within the net, and therefore the thresholds are so low. What we know so far about exemptions probable are healthcare and education, which has been very publicly mentioned. Over 100 essential commodities items, we don't know the list, but that's what we hear. Real estate, the residential leasing is going to be exempt, and probably the life insurance also is likely to be in the exempt category. Again, here we'll have to see whether it is really going to be in the exempt list or it is going to be in zero rated list. Because that will define for those entities involved in this businesses whether they'll be able to claim input VAT or not. So that's very critical to see, and we'll wait for the draft law. Now I'm just trying to attempt to take certain segment of the industry. What are some of the typical issues that we'll probably face in this likely scenarios? Trading business, the most common. So here I think, of course, as I said, for the trading business, if you are an intermediary, it's not a cost for you. However, you will have an excellent opportunity to see and plan if you can maximize your input credits. So let's say you consume a lot of goods directly available for input credit, but also if you are in a manufacturing segment and you have a large capex can be entire VAT paid on the capital expenditure will straight away become entitled to input VAT. So it might throw up some more planning opportunity whereby we may be able to maximize something on that side. What's most important will be the opening inventory. And it's going to impact everybody. Our recommendation, we feel that opening inventory, yes, there will be some kind of disclosure or a reporting that might be required. Of course, there's no tax paid on that so far. Hence, going forward, whenever you sell, whatever you collect, you'll not be able to claim input credit because you're not paid any tax thereon. And that entire amount that you collect will become payable to the government. You know? So, but again, for the businesses to start planning, 31st March is not that far. You'll need to see your systems, processes, define your inventory levels. And again, if you are in a business which has exempt goods, and also essential commodities and others which are normal rated goods, you need to bifurcate your systems, track all of them separately, and maintain records for them. This is where this challenge starts. So again, what happens to discounts? What happens to sales returns? What happens to goods in transit? Discounts are simple. It just reduces your sale consideration, and therefore it reduces the VAT computed thereon. Again, please note, these are all my personal views. We'll have to see exact law, how it is drafted, and we'll be able to then further debate as to how and what can be applied in precisely. Sales returns, typically in the other countries, they give a window of 3 to 6 months for businesses to claim adjustment or refund in respect to the sales returns. So we do expect some of that kind of mechanism will be put in place. Coming to retail chains and the most common examples, what if I want to go and exchange? Now, the issue here is that the retail chains are selling to end customer. They are not VAT registered. So if you exchange or take goods back from them, it's technically a purchase for you. And how do you deal with that? So that might throw up some amount of complication unless the law clarifies that part. VAT refund for tourists, again, so far the government has been very clear that at the moment there is no mechanism for issuing refunds. They are conducting a feasibility of how best they can implement this, but immediately 2018, this is not going to be in place. Maybe a year or a year and a half later, this might come up. And what will be most important for the retail chain or warehouses or depots or manufacturing units selling from different depots is to have a complete track of your inter-store or inter-warehouse inventory movements. As long as you are able to establish that this is not a sale for which the goods have been moved, it's fine. But if you are not having that record or detail, then it's a problem. Coming to online businesses, again, online sale has become a sizable part of the retail chain across the world in most of the jurisdictions, and we expect UAE to be no exception. Souq.com has been acquired by Amazon for $7 billion valuation, so they are going to push this more and more and hard and hard. However, typically, all of these platforms, on whether Souq or Amazon or anyone, they are all platforms where suppliers are displaying their goods and buyers are buying it. And therefore, typically across countries, the practice that they are following is that on supplies will be considered as dispatches or export based on the place of supply. So where your customer is based. So if I am a Souq.com, but if my customer is based in Oman, I will have to go and comply with VAT in Oman. So it will be driven by where your end customer is and where he's ordering from. If he's in Abu Dhabi, you'll have to go and comply with Abu Dhabi. If, God forbid, if you have separate compliances in each state. So that's the fundamental idea of a online say. And therefore, you may be conducting your business from one jurisdiction, but if your place of supply is at different locations, you will still need to go to those locations, register for VAT and comply there. And therefore, your compliance mechanism will have to be geared to meet those requirements. Import-export business, as I mentioned, you'll need to be aware of the reverse charge mechanism for VAT on imports, and of course, there is zero rate for exports. We'll come to the free zone discussion in a while. Again, as I mentioned, for manufacturing business, it could be a good planning where they can plan their capital expenditure in such a way that they can maximize their input credit in a particular year and benefit in that period. So that could be one opportunity. Again, if you are a manufacturing unit in RAK or in UAE or Dubai, but you are selling from different places, your place of sales and warehouses and depots and inter-unit movement, all that will be important. One needs to track it, needs to build the entire mechanism to track those movements and report it accurately. Service business, as I mentioned, the place of supply is the criteria at the moment. We are not clear about the export of services for the time being. I'm sure by the time law comes in, export of services will be clarified. And the challenge will be in case of utility and other service provider. It is a lot. Giving you a free iPhone or iPhone payment to be made over a 24 months or 12 month period. What happens? And that's where, again, the organization providing this, they will have to identify on day one what is the cost of the handset, what is the cost of services which is there in the bundle. And again, I'm not saying something new. If my accounting professionals will vouch for me, IFRS 15 mandates them to do that anyway. And the same treatment will need to follow for VAT as well. So I would rather go with following the accounting system. And whatever you're following there is what you need to follow for VAT as well. Because at the end of the day, if they ask you to audit, your accounting system will become the base of how and when you're charging it. Real estate. So one is very clear that the residential leasing is not subject to VAT. However, commercial leasing is. And therefore, if I am an owner of a building and I have ground floor only, which is commercial, rest all is residential. The most important part for me to see will be, as I said, that whether residential leasing comes as an exempt service or is it a zero rated. If it is exempt, all the input credit that I will be paying for on various things, I will lose it. Or I will have to segregate, prorate, I will have to determine very clearly that this much is for the commercial part of it. I've given a composite maintenance contract. Now, how much is it for residential? How much is it for commercial? They all will be VAT paid. Can I claim the full amount? No, sorry, you can't. So these are the challenges this will come up. So again, input VAT will be only for services that pertains to the taxable services. Contracting business, very typical. You spend over 1 or 2 years and you realize only at the end of the third year. And therefore, if you have progress billing, you will be able to match it. If not, whether you can go on claiming quarterly return refunds and then at the end you will start paying We'll see how the law is worded. But these are the challenges that that will throw up. And again, import of services, and how do you account for that? So free zones. UAE, very typically, we have free zones. Only very few of them are custom bound or has custom boundaries. Rest of them do not even have a custom boundary. So while you call yourself free zone and you are supposed to operate only within the free zone or with entities outside the UAE, the transactions within the free zone as well as the transaction with the local area companies are very, very common. Because it does not have a custom bound territory defined, it's likely that all the free zone entity will also need to comply with VAT. And the same areas of import-export. So import, you will have to charge VAT, claim it as an input credit, and output, if it is you are exporting out completely, it will be zero rated, but you'll be able to claim a refund of what you have paid. So compliance will definitely be there. Yes, if the goods do not even touch or enter UAE and it's shipped directly from one port to another and you're only recording, then you might be able to be out of that VAT net for that point. So this might become an area where, though technically maybe 70% of your business you're doing with countries outside UAE, but still you might be in the compliance net. We'll have to see how and when and what coverage comes up, but this is what is likely. Automobiles, if you give freebies, how do you deal with it? If you give extended warranties, how do you deal with it? And the service contract you do for next 3 years and 5 years, and how do you deal with it? So again, I would fall back on the accounting system that each of the company follows. As long as you have irrevocably received the consideration, the VAT will be leviable, irrespective of when you deliver the service. And it will have to be matched with your accrual concept and revenue recognition. And there's nothing new that I'm saying, but we are expecting the same way the law to come up. So I'm just mentioning a few other points generally which impacts. So all the LLCs, you charge management fees. Now suddenly services are taxable. So is your management fee also taxable? Technically, yes, because that's also a service that you are rendering. Interest to partners, so far we know that financial transactions are going to be outside the scope of VAT. Again, whether it will be exempt or zero rated, we'll have to see. That's how the banks will have a huge problem of complying, because half of their services will be exempt and rest will be taxable. So we are going to expect the most complex issues for banks to come up with this. So interest may not be taxable. Transitional provision, as I mentioned, that for the opening stock and all, you'll need to be careful how you manage and maintain those records and see where it takes it from there. Deposits, group VAT, somebody did mention that you please cover this, but technically the VAT liability is on an entity. And therefore, you might have a group registration concept or anything, but the entity is liable. So there's no group mechanism for VAT to follow. So I would not expect a group mechanism to come in this to have a common compliance or a common VAT number or no. Each legal entity wise, you'll have to go and segregate that separately. Consignment sales and consolidated business, where one part of the business is exempt and one is taxable. As I mentioned already, that one needs to be very, very clearly maintaining the divisional or segmental revenue, expenses, and cost attached to it, and then only claim it forward for VAT. Impact on business operation, first and foremost, everyone will have to change the software or upgrade the software, where your invoices are coming out of software, your POS systems, and all of that will need to be now VAT ready. Again, we are not expecting it to be a huge issue, because most of the software, if you're using the established software, they do have a mechanism. It's just that they have not enabled it for UAE, and they would be able to do that swiftly. I'm not saying, I mean, it's a big business for them as well, so don't worry about that, you know. But from a process point of view, the business needs to be ready, and therefore your documentation, your accounting, your systems, your internal controls, all we need to undergo that change. So invoice formats, billing processes, master data, because you need to then update all the data, VAT numbers of each customer, supplier, and everything. Item level VAT rates, breakup of taxable and non-taxable items, additional checks and controls. This is going to be the more important part. Whether you accurately captured all the information or not, is something missing out? Even error of your accountant will become an error for you. How do you justify it's just an error? Then reconciliation. How much VAT I have to claim, how much VAT I have to pay, what is the collection, what is the input, whether I'm entitled to claim, not. So quarterly reconciliations. Then reports and register, and of course, VAT returns related summary. So again, legal and other proof of transactions, tax invoices, record maintenance. As I mentioned, error by accountant could expose you for penalty. You need better accountants, and you need to train them properly. Both is most critical here. Late payment, when fines and penalties. So these are all that's likely. Gentlemen, with all this, I would now leave the floor open for Q&A. Yes, sir.
That was a wonderful presentation, but you've actually raised some issues which I'd like to just ask you further based on that. You said that the way that we account for under IFRS would actually be the same way that they would then treat that those transactions and you'll have to pay VAT. You mentioned once, which was the unbundling under IFRS 15, but there could be a lot of complications when IFRS 16 comes in because you take the future payments, you capitalize it.
True.
That's one thing. Second, it could be that under IFRS 3, where you have a business combination, we just had a thing with one of our clients, $300 million was taken to the income because it was a bargain purchase option, which means that it's negative goodwill, but it's taken to income. Will you have to pay VAT on that? That's something. But similarly, you could have the other way around, where there might be certain transactions which you're actually going, instead of expensing, you're capitalizing. Under IAS 23, if there's a borrowing cost, so how do you then, because in other countries, you've got two ways. One is the taxable income on which you actually pay, and one is your net profit, whatever you disclose. So will there be two sets of books that you'll have to maintain?
Very interesting, sir, and I was expecting this from you. Right, so technically, sir, one, for UAE companies, it's not mandatory to follow IFRS.